my twins in the Bronx were conceived over there. Churches are good. If they're ovulating on a Sunday, you can use a church restroom. They're always welcoming.
This is Ari Nagel. He's a 46-year-old maths professor, and being good with numbers is useful for the other hat he wears as a prolific DIY sperm donor.
Yeah, I've used Radio City Music Hall over there on the corner. They have beautiful restrooms, magnificent.
Ari's helped conceive more than 90 children, handing over his sperm in some quite unusual situations.
As I had a friend who was having a birthday party, like a cookout, I just grabbed one of these red Solo cups at the party. I go into the bathroom, I jerk off into the cup, I come back to the party and I tell everyone, nobody drink from this cup, you know? There'll be a lesbian couple here, they'll be here within the hour and they'll come pick it up and put the sperm inside.
Ari is among a growing number of private sperm donors. Recipients find him and others through word of mouth or via online forums and apps. He gives his sperm away for free and has built a whole persona around his super donor status.
My name is Ari Nagel, and people often ask me, what's my secret to having a high sperm count? I recommend Sperm XL.
But with demand for donor sperm booming, what does it mean for the next generation of donor-conceived kids? November is a big month for Ari Nagel. That's when he'll reach 100 biological children.
Well, I had two children born Thursday, so that's gonna be 94 or 95. Hey, how you doing? Oh, you did her hair so nice. She's got a nice little puff over there. Hey, cutie.
Ari says he's become a super sperm donor to help women in need.
Does she say any words? Say dada, dada.
But I want to know if there's anything else that drives him.
Hi, Ari, how are you?
Never been better.
Why do you keep doing this?
My motivation, I think, changed over time. Maybe when I, you know, had one child and it was a son, I wanted a girl, you know, so you have one of each. But after I had a boy and a girl, I was getting asked for help to grow their family by lesbian couples or heterosexual couples or single women whose biological clock was ticking. And I know how much joy my children brought me in knowing that I'd be able to help them have a lifetime of joy and happiness, you know, with little or no effort on my part.
There's no contract with Ari, no expectations on the recipients, and he says he doesn't turn anyone away.
Who's gonna catch the balloon? Good catch.
His level of contact with the children depends largely on what the parents want.
So it varies and it's different for each family. Some kids I see all the time and there's some kids I've never met. Some of my kids call me Ari and some of them call me Dad and some of them don't call me and some of them call me Donor Dad. And it's dynamic, so it changes.
Hey. Today, Ari is picking up one of his kids from childcare and taking her to lunch along with her mum.
You know, who's that? Who's that? Bye, Mia. Bye.
Oh, that was such a nice hello. Here we go. Oh, look at your smile.
Thank you, guys.
Oh, you're welcome, Aaliyah.
And she knows who you are.
Of course she does. That was sweet.
Ashley's had two daughters using Ari's sperm. Aria, named after her dad, and two-year-old Aaliyah.
I'm just getting some turkey sandwiches. You were good with that, or you want a something else?
Can you give her like a mac and cheese or something?
Oh yeah, I'll get her like a grilled mac and cheese sandwich.
She looks like you. Mm-hmm. Everyone tells me that, and I don't see it. This is the first time I actually seen it. You see it?
It's like I'm looking in the mirror. If you ask me,
she looks like him. When we first met him, after Aria was born, she was about maybe 2 months old, and we met her with. We met another sibling and he called Ari daddy and I like literally freaked out like, oh no, this is not what I wanted. But you know, as I grew and I realized it's good for her to have that person that she can, you know, have that label so she doesn't feel like she's missing out on anything. You know, he is pretty much the fun guy. He comes, he plays, he has fun. And I do all the heavy lifting. But he's always there when I ask him to be. So I've never had an issue with that.
And what about Ari? What do you think?
What do you think drives him?
What do I think drives Ari?
Yeah.
I used to think helping people is what was his main goal. Right now, I think it's numbers.
So tomorrow I'm going to Warsaw. I'm meeting a lesbian couple. They're from Poland. And I'm going to help them conceive.
Ari's nearly 100 biological children are spread out around the world. He's about to embark on a donating spree across Europe.
I'm going to take this shirt. It's my daddy's shirt.
Ari hands over the sperm in various ways. He demonstrates the cheapest and simplest method.
These are menstrual cups. They cost less than a dollar here. And basically, the sperm would go in here. And then they squeeze it, right? Very flexible. And then they'd put their foot up, right? And squat a little bit. And then they would just slide it in their vagina and leave it there for 12 hours. And I have 23 kids on the way. 8 of them were conceived in a clinic. The other 15 were all conceived using this soft cup.
There's not much holding Ari back. He's single. He has 3 kids conceived during a relationship, but they live with their mum. Even a global pandemic hasn't slowed him down.
I'm happy to report that the vaccine did not affect my fertility because it's actually made me more prolific. I don't have to go to work 4 days a week. So I'm just teaching online, so I'm able to travel while I'm helping the women conceive.
Ari says he donates for free and only asks recipients to cover his travel expenses.
Nice to meet you.
In contrast, getting sperm from a fertility clinic can cost thousands of dollars.
Wow, that's quite something.
We call this the patient lounge, so patients can relax here before and after procedures. Come on through, I'll show you the rest of the place. Often say we have the most.
Dr. Devorah Lieberman says demand for sperm is increasing, not just at her clinic, but globally.
We've seen a huge increase over the last 10, 20 years in people wanting to access donor sperm because of the rise of gay marriage and the acceptability of queer and gay family building. With single women now, the stigma around being a single parent is gone, pretty much.
In the face of competition from the informal donor market, fertility clinics have positioned themselves as a safer alternative.
I think when you come to a clinic like ours, you have the knowledge and assuredness that it's clean, that you're not putting yourself at risk of infection.
And those assurances are what clients are willing to pay for.
I will show you where the sperm is stored.
Before it gets to this point into one of these tanks, what has the process been for this sperm?
Right, so the donor will have had his infection screens done. They'll have had a semen analysis, and then the sperm get washed and concentrated, and the best and the brightest get put into vials and frozen in liquid nitrogen.
This is the cream of the crop.
This is the cream of the crop.
Devorah says there's no place for super donors like Ari Nagel at clinics like hers.
I think it's quite terrifying to think that a single donor could be responsible for hundreds of children with no traceability, no way to know who your siblings are.
In Australia, there are state-based laws that govern how clinics operate. Some states place limits on how many families or women a donor can give sperm to. In New South Wales, that number is 5 women. In some other countries, like the US, there are no legislated limits. But even here, it's an honesty system.
How do you know that the men who donate through your clinic haven't donated privately or in other states or other countries?
Our donors will sign forms stating that they have not been donors previously. I mean, I guess they could lie on a legal document, but I don't know that it would be in their interest to do so, and I'm not sure why they would bother coming to be a donor in a clinic if they've been donating free range previously.
The reality is there's nothing to stop someone donating at a clinic and privately at the same time. There are various apps and Facebook groups that connect donors and recipients across the globe.
Okay, so this is like Tinder for people who want to find a sperm donor. And it's basically, you know, you get photos, you get a bit of a bio about the people, and you swipe left or right.
Apps like this one give people control. There's no fertility clinic acting as an intermediary, no laws defining the parameters of the donor-recipient relationship.
This guy says, it's hard to explain why I'm here, but I've got some friends going through IVF at the moment, and they told me how hard it is to find a donor. Seems like a really, you know, nice thing to do.
There are also no rules on how the sperm is transferred.
This guy here says he's only does natural insemination, which means he only wants to have sex in order to have a baby.
It's clear when using these apps that there are guys here who aren't being upfront about their donating histories. Alan Fan is an Australian super donor. According to reports, he conceived 23 children in just 1 year. His actions were reportedly investigated by the Victorian Assisted Reproductive Authority. His profile online is still active and only mentions 2 children. When I contacted Alan Fan to clarify numbers, he claims he hadn't helped that many people and that he no longer donates to Victoria. For some, the informal donor market is all they have. Not everyone can access sperm through a clinic.
W Polsce nie mamy takiej opcji. Mamy problem ze względu na polskie przepisy, na nasze prawo.
Karolina and Agnieszka have been together for nearly 2 years. Poland's ruling Conservative Law and Justice Party has recently cracked down on LGBT rights. Same-sex couples are not legally recognised. They can't adopt children and they can't access donor sperm at a fertility clinic.
Więc większość par, które przechodziły przez całą procedurę za granicą.
The couple have had some disappointing and unsettling interactions when looking for a local donor online. One guy had no intention of actually donating. He was just curious to meet a lesbian couple.
On mówi, że to takie było... Chciałem zobaczyć parę i tyle. Wtedy to był kryzys, nie?
Pierwszy. Tak, wtedy był nasz kryzys.
Wtedy to był pierwszy kryzys na zasadzie,
że... Przestałyśmy o tym rozmawiać przez jakiś czas. O tym dziecku. Żeby się całkiem nie załamać w sumie. Takie przykre trochę było. No ale później znowu.
Now the couple are putting their hopes in super donor Ari Nagel, who's arriving in Warsaw today. Karolina has 3 children from an earlier relationship, but this will be Agnieszka's first time trying for a baby. They found Ari online.
I było hasło, to wiesz co to napisz? Ja myślę sobie, no z Ameryki ktoś nam odpisze akurat. No i napisałam na Facebooku, znalazłaś go. I napisałam, że piszemy z Polski, z Europy, nie wiedziałam, czy wie, gdzie jest Polska. Okazało się, że ma korzenie polskie. Jego...
Kto?
Babcia chyba. Tak, jego babcia była Polką.
To wydaje się taki wesoło otwarty.
Najpierw było
szalony,
oczy, nie?
Myślę.
Wow. Oczy. Akceptację dostał?
Fajne oczy.
Tak?
No. Loczki też ma fajne.
Loczki. A i wydaje się taki dość sympatyczny, otwarty, więc mam nadzieję, że to też w genach jakoś przejdzie.
Ready to get the baby right now. Good to see you. But are you fertile today? Are you ovulating?
Ja nie rozumiem. To Karolina będzie tłumaczyć.
Aha.
Yes, we, yes.
She
we're going through, yes.
She thinks she is fertile.
Jesteś mój tłumacz. She has no idea what's going on.
Ah, so, better that way. Yeah. Ask her if she's horny, then you know that maybe she's fertile.
She is totally stressed now, so I
have
to take her
out. Oh, yes. Oh, don't de-stress her. Okay, that helps. It's better if you don't understand what we're saying.
Make sure the camera gets my big boner.
you know? These cute girls I'm sitting in between,
yeah, right.
You know? When I produce the sample later, I'm gonna Google hot Polish lesbians, you know? That's what I'm gonna get my inspiration, you know? Unless you wanted to share some original footage.
Yeah, right.
Back at the hostel, Ari gets straight down to business, ready to produce a sample. In the room next door, Karolina and Agnieszka are nervously waiting.
Aga schowała się w toalecie, tak. Stresa ma biedna. Od samego początku miała, tak więc zobaczymy, co z tego będzie.
Ari has done this hundreds, if not thousands of times. For Agnieszka, it's a first. For the women, the stakes are high. But their first impressions of Ari seem positive.
No czuję te emocje wszystkie, no, także... Ale ogólnie to... Fajny facet.
Fajny facet, no.
Fajny.
A jakie to są emocje?
Pozytywne. Nie mam nadziei, że to będzie ten traf taki.
Dzisiaj?
Już?
To już?
Well done.
And now? Already? So
it was, what is she nervous about? It's not like I'm sticking my dick in there. Just the keys.
Okay.
I just left it over there in the napkin. Okay.
So tell us...
Don't drink it. Because I came a long way, you know?
Are you crazy?
Listen, yeah. I know what kind of pervert you are, you know?
I won't tell you. Okay.
I know it doesn't look like a lot for all this long distance that I traveled, but there's 100 million there, you know?
I have oranges.
And I'll see you later.
Okay, we'll be in contact.
Okay.
She's stressed.
She's fine.
I hope so.
No, ale ogólnie to poczułam takie coś... Coś fajnego, takie szczęście w sumie. Jak patrzyłam w oczy Karoliny, tak sobie pomyślałam, że jak wyjdzie, to teraz, że będę w ciąży, to no będzie super. Naprawdę, nawet no nie mogę tego objąć w słowa. No, no szczęście takie. Że w końcu ten moment nadszedł.
Myślicie o... Ari będzie nazywany tatą czy dawcą? Jak o tym myślicie?
Nie no, w tym momencie, jeśli to będzie...
Nie no, myślę, że...
Tatą.
Nie będzie anonimowy dawca. Numerek z banku gdzieś tam, tylko będzie konkretną osobą, o której maluch będzie wiedział. No to nie może być dawcą.
Not everyone is as willing to be as transparent as Karolina and Agnieszka. In fact, there's a long history of parents not telling their child that their donor conceived.
So I think a lot of people who are using donor sperm are really focused on getting to the baby, you know, holding that baby in their arms. It's good to remember that that baby is immediately going to start growing up and will be a completely independent person with their own thoughts and feelings.
Erin Jackson runs an information service for donor conceived people. She wants people to understand what it's like to not know your genetic history.
In 2015, my mother told me that the man who raised me is not my biological father. This came as a huge shock to me. I went online and ordered a 23andMe DNA test. And when the test results came back, I had a couple of big surprises. I would guess that I probably have 100 siblings. When I was conceived, and today in the United States, there are no regulations on the maximum number of people that one individual sperm or egg donor can help to make. It was quite traumatic just to understand that I was separated intentionally from my truth and my siblings.
Erin is part of a global movement of donor-conceived people calling for change. She runs an annual survey through her website, and while it's a small group of about 500 people, there are some clear points of consensus.
I did ask people, you know, if there were to be a limit on offspring produced from one donor, what would that limit be? And the majority said a maximum of 10 offspring. And that's because it would allow the donor-conceived people to build meaningful relationships with the donor and with their siblings. I think one of the most important findings is that donor-conceived people do not support anonymous sperm or egg donation. And the majority think that this information about the donor's identity should be available to the donor-conceived person from birth.
This is a caricature drawing I made on a detective program when I was, I think, like 5 years old. And I literally just took all the physical descriptions I got of my donor and I made this.
Quill, who uses the pronouns they or them, is 14 years old. Until quite recently, they had no idea what their biological father looked like.
This is the closest I could get. So yeah, I remember I made this kind of desperation to get to know what he looked like.
Quill pieced the face together using a donor profile with a list of facial features that was provided to their mum, Anne.
What do we got? What are the eyebrows like? Like, he's got thick eyebrows. Yep, that's come through. Yeah.
Anne is a single mother by choice. Quill was conceived using donor sperm and a donor egg at a clinic in the US.
Pointy chin, no cleft. You don't have a cleft either, do you?
What's that?
It's like if you have a sort of...
Like butt chin.
The clinic told Anne she could have contact with the egg donor, but there were strict rules around contacting the sperm donor.
They only offered two choices: anonymous forever, never know who they are, or open, which there are rules where that was a commitment on behalf of the donor that they would have at least one contact with the donor-conceived person at the age of 18 or over, and that had to be through the cryobank.
In the formal fertility industry in Australia, it's also standard practice to only provide identifying details about a sperm donor when a child turns 18. That's a long time to go without answers.
Like, it's a human right, it's a big part of people to be able to get to know their genetic family. And I think to deny them that because of their age is just shocking.
Quill wanted to know who these people were and wanted to have some contact and be able to speak to them and maybe go to America and have a visit and things like that. And had questions that I couldn't answer.
I think it's really important to get to know your cultures and your ancestors and your family story. Hello, I'm Quill, I'm 10 years old, I live in Queensland, and it's an extremely large chance you're my sperm donor.
4 years ago, Anne and Quill found their sperm donor using a DNA test. Quill then sent him a letter.
I'd love to get to know you, so please contact me again on this email or at this Facebook. If you don't want to contact me right now, I completely understand. However, please let me know. Thanks.
The donor's reply was positive.
I was bouncing off the walls. I was so excited to see his letter and kind of see what kind of person he is through that. And I was so, so thankful that my hopes had turned out to be true and that he really was a good person hoping to have contact with me. I know that most of my personality comes from my mum, and she raised me. I'm really glad that I'm so similar to my mum, but I think I've also got stuff from my egg donor and my sperm donor. I definitely see that I have three branches of my family tree. I have the main one from my mum, and then the two other ones from my sperm and egg donors. Yeah, I think there's definitely room in my family tree for three branches.
Hi, how you doing?
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, good, good. How you doing? Look at beautiful, look at Warsaw, it's beautiful.
In Poland, DIY super sperm donor Ari Nagel is planning his next few deliveries.
Tomorrow I'm going to Krakow and I'll be freezing sperm there on Wednesday for a woman from France. And then I'm going to Prague, and I'll be freezing sperm for women from Germany there on Friday and on Monday. And then I might go to Tbilisi, or I could go to Spain, or I could go wherever else you need. Fast?
Very fast.
I speak fast and I also ejaculate very fast also. I'm a professional. But it's better if you don't understand what I'm saying.
Ari dedicates a lot of time and effort into donating sperm all over the world. And even though some recipients cover his expenses, he admits he can be left out of pocket.
Is it an addiction? Like, is it a kind of compulsion to keep doing this?
No, it's not, you know. Listen, if I gave too much charity, is that an addiction? You know, but it feels good knowing I'm able to help people.
Ari doesn't think he needs to cap his donating in line with laws in countries like Australia, where donors can only give to a limited number of families.
I'm sure the kids will be resenting it, and I'm sure there's going to be kids that are going to appreciate it. To me, the more the merrier. That's just always been my policy.
Do you think there could be some parents who just never tell the child that their donor conceived or that your sperm was used to conceive them?
Definitely. I think that's often the case for heterosexual couples. They're not sharing and not truthful with the child. But I leave the door open, so if the women don't want me to play a role now, but in the future they change their mind, then that's definitely an option that I'm open to.
What would you say if there is a child that comes to you in 15 or 20 years and, you know, you didn't know about them and they didn't know about you until, you know, suddenly it's revealed through a DNA test? What would you say to them if they're upset when they come to you?
Listen, I have 95 children. I'm sure many will be upset and many of them will be appreciative. You know, I think I'm gonna get everything under the sun. I don't really have the answers, to be honest. You know, what the future is gonna hold, I am making it up as I get along, and I'm sure that'll happen.
You know, I've been kind of thinking about what would motivate you to do this, whether it's a numbers game, like you're just trying to push the numbers up.
Numbers game, you know, these women want their first child, you know? So I should say, well, I don't really want to have any more children because it's not going to look right. People are going to think I have too many and might think I'm narcissistic, you know? But then the women, they don't care. They just want their one child.
I think people who knowingly want to create 100 children, that kind of impulse to me is just really tells me that there's a mental health issue at play. And they're clearly doing it for their own self-interest. Maybe it's a big ego trip for him. I mean, if he was listening to the voices of donor-conceived people, he would have stopped a very long time ago.
Advocates like Erin Jackson say it's not about who Ari Nagel is to the women he donates to. Uh-huh. It's about who he is to the children he's helping create.
What this all comes down to is one person's, you know, sperm donor is another person's biological parent.
We've reached a point where nearly anyone and everyone can create a human life. Relationship status, sexual preference, financial means are no longer barriers. But while conceiving a child is a moment in time, the legacy is forever.
I definitely think that if you're going to conceive a child through donor conception, that you need to be prepared for the crazy journey that they'll have to go on. You're gonna have to be prepared to get in contact with the donors, to explain to your child why the family's different. And yeah, even though it might just be a single cell, a single donation to you, it's definitely, it could be a big thing to the child.